Here's the main chassis up on the workbench, getting ready to work on it. As I noted earlier, it's original, including the thermistor, which often fails or falls out. It's this disc here that provides a soft startup to the filaments on power up. And this guy, which is a filament dropper. So it's a series wired set. If you add up all the tube filament voltages, you don't get 120 volts. So that's what this is for. And also, there was an option with this set for a UHF tuner. If you have that, you've got a couple tubes in the tuner in that filament string, so you would short out a suction here. And also, one of these is in parallel with the dial lamp. And this guy, when it's cold, I believe it's a 120 ohm or something thereabouts, or 200 ohms maybe. And when the set warms up, it lowers its resistance. Although this one seems to be okay, I'll replace with a modern one from Amitherm. Likewise, I'll be replacing this because these are high failure components. I want to make sure this set is reliable. So the next thing up that I'm going to do is just get to it and pull out that main board, which from the many threads I've seen in forums online is what people really seem to have an issue with. Well, I've done a number of videos on predictives now, and I've done enough of these that I don't find them to be daunting at all. A couple things to keep in mind. All the wires are different colors, and when you take them off, they generally stay in the area of where they were. So like when you unwrap them, they're going to kind of be hanging out in the same general area. So I don't mess around with tags or anything like that. And with regard to cutting these wires and putting little connectors in there so you could take the board out and put it back in, when I take this board out, I just replace everything. Only once have I ever had to take a board back out, and I believe that was because I screwed up with one of these and I did not solder one of the connections and a replacement network. So these are little networks, which is the second thing that people seem to really have issues with. There are multiple components inside of here. You can see each one of these cylinders is another component. Most of them are resistors, also some capacitors, which I believe are tubular ceramic. Generally, these are pretty reliable. However, if you take one out and measure it, you'll find the resistors have drifted off value because they're made out of carbon, just like these guys, carbon comp. And the ones in the vertical section, these guys tend to develop problems, especially this one, which in conjunction with this cap right here have a lot of voltage. They are in the vertical circuit and they get a bit of a good kickback from the vertical oscillator and yoke winding. So it's a 1000 volt cap, and you've got a pretty good voltage on the caps in here too. So it's generally advised to replace that guy. And this is a vertical integrator, which confuses people because of the way it's shown on the schematic. We'll talk more about that later, but right now I want to get this board out. It's held in by wires that are wrapped around stakes. Most of them are not soldered. All I gotta do is undo the wire and they will come off. I'm sure they had a tool. When I first started messing around with computer stuff in the 80s, wire wrapping was still a thing, and I had a little handheld tool where you'd put the wire in, or you'd strip off the end, put the stripped end in the tool and twist it around. It would do sort of wire wrap connections. I know there were motorized guns that would do it, so I'm sure in the factory they were just going bzz, 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 and putting these on. Well, I don't have such a tool, so I'll do it the old-fashioned way with some needle nose pliers. I That wasn't too bad. A little over 10 minutes total. So I'm just going to get to it and start replacing things. Something else I should point out that's a potential source of problems is these tube sockets, specifically the 9-pin. The way these work is the inner ring is where the two pins go. The outer ring are the pegs that go down through holes on the circuit board. Between them is a bit of metal. These are kind of thin. What will happen is from repeated tube insertions and removals and wiggling around, they can crack. That's why when I took this tube out, I was careful to get a small flat-bladed screwdriver in. In through the keyway, pry it up. These look to be in really good condition there, probably because all these tubes, except for video out and horizontal oscillator, appear to be originals. So there just hasn't been any insertion or removal, so I'm inclined to leave them alone. I'll leave that tube out for now. I'll be taking the rest of them out, of course, to test them. And it makes it easier to work on the surrounding components. I've heard reports of charred boards, but I really haven't seen it in any of the sets I've worked on. Maybe the 17-inch sets are more prone to that. I've got a couple, but I haven't worked on them yet. But I've worked on a bunch. I think three Howlers will be four. This is my sixth or seventh of this type of chassis, and haven't had any issues with foil lifting up or charred boards. So I'm not sure how much of an issue that is. Now, the Holiday models, the boards are sitting upwards, so the heat radiates up. And this model, they're sideways. Seems to be the only way you'd really get charred boards is if they're like this, or its tubes are running awfully hot. There are a few power resistors. I don't see any charging under them. No, those could be a low hour set. When I replace these, across the board, I try to use higher wattage resistors. So 1 watt in place of 1/2 watt, 2 watt replace of 1 watt, 3 in place of 2 watt. Why? Well, not only are they more reliable, but they run cooler. Also, I lift them a bit up off the board. I'm just about done with the main board, save one obvious thing missing, which is the networks, which I've taken out, and I'm going to be making some replicas. But before I do that, I want to do work on the main chassis. So I've got that up on the workbench now. Not much on the top side, but underneath. Bunch of parts I want to replace. So Bumblebee caps got to go, paper caps. I want to replace this guy with some modern power resistors. I want to replace the thermistor with a modern thermistor and replace the electrolytics inside these cans. I started in this corner, but I'm working my way down this way. I just noticed something, my first evidence of work having been done on this set. We've got a wire here, it's been cut off and going to nothing. And this capacitor lug has nothing on it. And there's an X written on the can right there. Well, it should be a resistor going between these two lugs as well. This wire should be hooked up to something. Here's original service info, and there's an R10 down in here between lugs 1 and 2. So I believe that would be lug 1, which has nothing going to it. There's R10 right here. So either way, I'll have to look to see exactly which section was cut off. We'll see, it's E11, that's E12, so that's section 1. That is the main filter cap right off after the filter choke, 100 microfarad, 300 volt. You can't get by without that. That's not going to work right, but I haven't seen any other cap fit anywhere else under here. So maybe it was an old repair attempt and they didn't get any further than that? I don't know. trace this wire out. I think it goes over down. It's going to a dual diode rectifier down here. That might actually be E14. And it's this guy that got cut. So none of the set, I can see the set still working if you took this cap out. But not very well, because that is, well, kind of part of the voltage doubler. So we got this cap here, two rectifiers, and then this cap here, and together those form a voltage doubler. Now with that out of the picture, and this filter choke with this cap in place, this is going to somewhat take up the slack from this guy. I mean, it's still going to work, but not nearly as well. So I imagine this set had low B plus and perhaps a bit of ripple with that capping out of the circuit. Let's see. Grab a flashlight and see if I can see the actual symbol on that lug and verify which section it is. Okay, that is a half moon, which is, I can't quite see. So it's 350 volts. Can't see the capacitance. Let's loosen this up and rotate it a little bit. Well, I'm not 100% sure that this is the original cap either, because it looks rather long compared to others that I've seen. Well, it has a Philco part number. 140 microfarad, 350 volts. Yeah, so that section is has been disconnected. Well, replacing that will certainly help the performance. And then there's this cap, which may be original. The soldering job looks like it could be stock, but that cap looks awfully new. And it does not say Philco or a Philco part number that I can see. 150, and the original was 140 microfarad, not 150 microfarad. Well, yeah, it was interesting that was the way it's rated. 150 microfarad, 200 volts, but also 1.5 amps at 60 cycle. And that's something you see too often, is the current rating stated right on there. Important to when you're running a voltage doubler is that this thing needs, because all the current that's going to power the B plus for the whole set is going through that cap. So it's got to have decent current handling capability. Alright, so yeah, definitely gotta replace that cap. Otherwise, everything else matches up perfectly with parts placement diagram and schematic. So I will continue on with the work. Here's the full schematic. So on two pages, I just made a nice clean cut on one edge, and then matched up the two sides and taped it together so I have a continuous schematic. I'm turning my attention to the power switch now, which, as we saw in the first installment, is very flaky. Luckily, I've got a replacement. The trick is to get this off. I've already disconnected the two wires that would go to it. I know I've done this once before, but it's been a little while, and I don't quite remember what all was involved. So I got four lugs on here, and I want to put it on here, but can't exactly get the old ones off unless you start disassembling the whole thing. Which is maybe what I did. I can't quite remember. But since this one is pretty well shot anyways, no harm in dissecting it, so I'm going to pry these three off and take this part out. I ended up having to break the control completely down, but I got the new switch on there. And while I was at it, I cleaned up all the contacts inside the wipers with deoxit, and now I'm just putting the last section back on. Here's a little more evidence of past work having been done. The original germanium rectifiers have been replaced with these guys, which I am going to replace with some 1N5408
Ready for 2 amps, 1,000 volts. Here's how I ended up mounting the new diodes. I decided not to try to reuse this. It's kind of grungy looking. And this ceramic cap had seen better days. So here are the two new diodes, caps across them. And while I was at it, I figured, hey, it's a great place to mount this electrolytic. It's the one that had been clipped out of the circuit entirely. So nice, neat, to secure a little place to put those. I did that on some other predictive sets I've worked on as well. I'm wondering, what are these little caps for? Well, you see those on the schematic here. I wasn't sure what they were for until fairly recently. I read up it's to suppress some transients that get generated by the rectifiers. So a little 0.001 microfarad, 1,000 volt caps on there. And I replaced the power resistor here, which is the with control. Here's a demonstration of the replaced power switch working. Making pretty good progress on the underside of the chassis. Should be ready to start putting things back together soon. Rather than restuff the big electrolytic that was here, I installed a terminal strip and installed three of the new caps here, the other one's on the top side. Few more caps to install. A few things to note. One is this cap here was a big 0.1 microfarad. That's on the AC line. Got to replace that with a safety type cap. It's this guy right here, C2. Something else is these two guys. They seem to be the source of some confusion. This is a series strung set, meaning that all the tube filaments are connected in series and they go right across the AC line. Well, if you add all these up, you do not get the 117 volts AC that the set was designed for. Well, part of that is taken up by this. It's just connected in series with all the tubes. Just produces heat that's just there to burn off some excess power because the tubes don't add up to 117. That is this thing here. 13 ohm, 17 ohm, and 8 ohm. This one's nice because it actually is still legible on here. This one appears to be good, but these are a very common source of failure. And you can see it's starting to form some oxide here, that green crud. These oxidize and go open, or they just burn out. So I'm going to be replacing that. I picked up some of these power resistors, common enough power resistors, but this type, one lead is extra long and it wraps around the side, so I can mount three of them in like this. So it'll be a nice, neat installation, I think. The rest of the power is taken up by this guy, which is a thermistor, or more commonly these days called an inrush current limiter, or ICL. That is what this thing is. 400 cold, 11 hot. This is made out of a special material such that its temperature, its resistance depends on temperature. The hotter it is, the lower the resistance. When a set is cold, or I should say tube filaments when they are cold, have a lower resistance and will draw more current. Without this, there's a surge of current when you turn the set on, which could shorten the life of the tubes or even burn them out. So this will provide a high resistance when you turn the set on, limit the current, gradually gets warmer, resistance drops, allows more current to flow into the tubes. Another common point of failure. This one again appears to be okay, but what typically happens with these is the joint on either side fails and the disc sometimes will just fall out. I found one rattling around inside the cabinet with two leads just hanging there. Luckily, they are still made today, although I couldn't find any that were 400, but these are 220 cold. So I put two of them in series, so you get 440 cold and a few ohms when they're hot. These are made by Amitherm SL1522101, rated for 1 amp, operation. This is a 600 milliamp string. That's pretty close. Now, if you're wondering why is this in three sections, well, part of that is because there's an optional UHF tuner that would fit in here. When you have the UHF tuner, it has two more tubes in it, so you can knock out one section of this. Another section is there, parallel with the pilot light, which only draws 250 milliamps, so you can't put that in the current string, which draws 600 milliamps, so put that in parallel, so some of the current flows through this resistor, some flows through the pilot light. Pilot light burns out, the set will still have current running through it, but things won't be quite right. Won't be quite the proper amount of current flowing through the tubes. Enough that the set would still likely work all right. So I've got that to replace, a few more paper caps to go. I want to replace that guy. And then we get to the networks, sometimes called K-networks, because that's what Sam's called them in their service info. The original Philco service info calls them N-networks. For example, that's N5. Well, I went ahead and I drew them all up in a schematic program, so I have one schematic per network or couplate. They are also commonly referred to as N1 through N5. And I labeled them as to what they do. So this is the sink separator, for example. Here's the components and the leads. So let's see, I'll pull that one up. 6012. I think it's this guy. Yes, 36519-2. So there's pinouts. Here's the components. So inside here are resistors and capacitors. People have been asking me, ever since I first started working on these, what do I use to replace these with? I don't know what they used originally. I dissected some, used my best guesses. They appear to be carbon composition resistors. They drift high in value, just like all the other carbon composition resistors used in this. The capacitors, just because by their physical size and the construction, I think they're ceramic. There's a whole bunch of different types of ceramic. I don't know what they used. Could be NP0, could be X7R, could be any one of the other Z5U, any of the other ceramic temperature coefficients out there. I don't know what they used. I have used mica caps in the past. I've used NP0 or C0G type ceramics, and I've used some plastic film caps. They all seem to work all right. Lately, I've been using the ceramics simply because they're small and cost effective. I use all C0G types, which have the best temperature coefficient, meaning the capacitance does not change as the voltage, or sorry, as the temperature changes. So here are some. Sometimes you see them called NP0, sometimes you see them referred to as C0G, it's the same thing. These little blue guys here. So that's what I'm going to be using to make these up. And for resistors, I use half-watt metal film. Quite often, these will work just fine. But since the ones I've measured, resistors are drifting off in value, I figure, well, I've got this set out. It's not that much work to make them. I might as well. And some of these are known to fail, particularly the ones in the vertical circuit. And this set, not surprisingly, has vertical problems, and this is the main one, vertical feedback. And this one, you got to be careful, because this capacitor in particular, she uses a high voltage cap, 1,000 volts is a pretty high voltage spike that goes on there, the vertical feedback network. This guy right in here. There's an external 1500 picofarad 1 kilovolt cap, and it goes right into this one, going to ground. So if I use, and I also use the 1 kilovolt cap for that guy. Which leads us to this, which is another big source of confusion, is what the heck is this? We've got a line, 0.004, and then a 90K. That is a vertical integrator. Every TV's got one. For example, here's a GE set I'm also working on right now, and here's the same thing, but laid out differently. 68K, 68K, 150 picofarad, 800 picofarad. What it is it's a resistor with typically three capacitors off of it. It forms an integrator. It's a pulse forming network. The reason they show it in that odd way on the schematic, let me pull it up here, is because they built it with hybrid technology, something that you can't do with discrete components. Meaning that, where'd it go? Inside that package, they were able to form basically like a capacitor resistor sandwich. It's inside here. So think of it as like a resistor with a metal tube wrapped around it. Well, you can't do that with discrete components, so simply split it up. Instead of a 90K resistor, we have two 47K resistors. Instead of a 4,000 picofarad cap, I got three 1,500 picofarad caps. I've also used 1,200, I used 1,600. They all seem to work just fine. 45K, 47K. It's not that picky a circuit, it seems to me. So this is the equivalent to this. I'm tentatively thinking of making up a few extras and selling them on eBay. I can't guarantee I will do that for now, but I'm definitely going to make up a set for this set.